morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Disciples in training. I love it. Thank you, Dalton. You did a great job. How is everybody this morning?
Good.
Good. Good. Glad you're here this morning. I hope you're enjoying your holiday weekend. We will integrate some Memorial Day themes and music into our time together this morning as we remember those who have given their lives in service to our country. We have any birthdays and anniversaries to acknowledge today? It is not your birthday, Blake. I call your attention to announcements that Rachel has.
Yeah, I just had an anniversary. They're not here, but you know me, the Stephen Shoemaker.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday was their anniversary, and they announced that they're welcoming a baby in December.
Oh, really? Amanda is a part of our Acts 2 study group, our young adult study group, that began during our Crazy Love series back in Lent and will be resuming in a couple of weeks on June the 8th, as we'll talk about a little bit more in a moment. Some announcements in the back of your bulletin. First, I want to draw your attention to two Memorial Day services that are being held in the community tomorrow. In South Hill, the service will be at 11 a.m. and that's sponsored by the American Legion Post 79, that will be at Veterans Memorial Park. The service in Lunenburg County will be at Lakeview Cemetery in Victoria, sponsored by the VFW and American Legion Post. That's at 5:30 tomorrow evening. Reverend Mike Johnson, who's pastor of the Nottoway Lunenburg Charge, which includes Thrift Chapel and St. Mark's United Methodist Churches, will be the speaker tomorrow. So I hope that you'll find the time to remember those who have served and died in service to our country through those services. Some other announcements coming up this week. We have on Wednesday, worship with the residents at Pineview. That's at 10 a.m. And then choir practice is at 7 o'clock on Wednesday night. If you would like to sing, I hope you will come out and be a part of that. And then this weekend is Neighbors Helping Neighbors Weekend. I was talking with Tim Beck this morning, the pastor of Kimbridge United Methodist Church. About 100 volunteers have signed up. We have 8 projects in total that we'll be working with. We will gather at Kimbridge Church at 7 a.m. on Friday morning for breakfast. And then from there, we'll be sent out on our various work assignments and teams. Earl is heading up one of our work projects again this year. If we don't finish a project on Friday, then we'll go back to work on Saturday. If you're only coming on Saturday, you're not going to be a part of Friday's work, but are coming on Saturday, make sure you are at Kimbridge Church by 7:30 Saturday morning, and then you'll be sent out on a project from there. Wear your green t-shirts on Friday. Okie dokie. Questions? Awesome. Next Sunday is the first Sunday in June, so we'll have, after worship, we'll have Eat and Meet, covered dish luncheon following service. And then our church council meeting will be after that. So I hope that everybody will come for lunch, and you are all welcome to stay for the church council meeting as well. Yes, ma'am.
I will be contacting some of you ladies to help with the meal.
Okay, thank you. A couple other things I just want to draw your attention to. We are looking for folks who will serve as greeters. You can see Katie Overby, who's in the nursery this morning. If you want to serve in worship as a worship leader, talk to me. And then we're also looking for nursery workers. And Jenna's not here this morning, and I think she has the sign-up list. So keep that in mind that we're staffing at our nursery through the end of the year. So maybe next Sunday bring your calendar with you when you come to worship. We're also preparing our kits for a conference, and the instruction and item list is in the bulletin. We're doing health kits and school kits. Everything you need to know is on that yellow piece of paper. We'll be collecting those and blessing them on Sunday, the 12th of June, before we go off to annual conference. And then finally, I want to mention to you this morning on the bulletin insert that has the prayer list on one side, and we're going to have a super summer on the other. Our summer sermon series, our summer super sermon series, will be based on a book by James W. Moore called Some Folks Feel the Rain, Others Just Get Wet. time. We'll be spending time talking about gratitude and embracing the opportunities that come to us in life, oftentimes as challenges, and how our outlook on life helps us cope or not cope very well with those challenges. And so that's what we'll spend the summer talking about, is using that book as a resource. During our children's time throughout the summer, we do not do children's church during the summer months, but during our children's time, we're going to use an illustrated earth celebrating God's creation every week. So there'll be some Bible activities and information that are focus on God's creation and stewardship, good use of our resources. And I think that you will, adults will find it informative as well as the kids as well. And then one other thing I want to mention is in the month of July at Williams Church, we'll begin our worship services over there in July at 9 a.m. And we are going to spend a little bit of time in worship, some music and prayer. We'll take up our offering. And then we'll spend the bulk of our time together studying the book of Jeremiah. For 5 Sundays in July, we're going to be studying the word of the prophet who brings in the midst of despair and gloom and destruction and the falling apart of the nation and the church, a message of hope. And that'll be our emphasis at Williams during the month of July. I'll be teaching that class, and you are all invited to come. So you can do that from 9 to 10:30, and then come over here and get the Some Folks Feel the Rain worship experience as well. Just spend the whole summer morning with us. Our study sessions pick up on in the second week of June. Our young adult group is meeting on Tuesday nights. The second and fourth Tuesday, that will start on the 8th. That group will be studying the book of Luke. Our older adult groups, our daytime group, and then our nighttime group, second and fourth Wednesdays, from 10 to 11:30 for the daytime group, and from 6 to 7:30 for the evening study, and both of those will be focused on the book of Jeremiah. And that will be different content than what we'll be doing in July and Wednesday. But all of it will be about the book of Jeremiah. So I hope this summer, in between your vacations and your downtime and your rest and relaxation, that you'll find and take advantage of some opportunities to engage in some study as well as some special worship. Any questions about any of that or other announcements?
We have a special visitor, it looks like.
We do. Not a visitor, part of the family. Lydia. Who have you got with you this morning?
I've got Natalie and...
And how old is Natalie today?
She is 7 weeks.
7 weeks.
Okay, 8 weeks Tuesday.
8 weeks on Tuesday. It is good to have you and Natalie with us.
I've got one thing I
want
to say. This little girl has been putting on a prayer list every Sunday. Her name is Ashley Burnett. A little background. I don't know her personally, I just know her grandpa. He's been filling me in. And I think she's maybe 10 or 11 and started having seizures. And you know how seizures can disrupt your life when she got where she couldn't function. So they took a part of her brain. And that was successful for a while. And then the seizures started coming back. And then they decided, I think it was last winter, put an electrode in her neck and to stimulate and block off the surgery and medicine, and it wasn't working. And on May the 2nd, they were at the point where they were going to a specialist in Texas, maybe John Hopkins or somewhere. They were to that point. She was having 2 to 3 seizures an hour, and couldn't make it. And she was at home and went to the fridge to get some out of the fridge and fell. Hit her head on that side where she had, the operation hit her head really hard. And she hadn't had a seizure since, which is really good news. But I talked to Hildred this week. She was a little bit dizzy. They're still trying to work on medication. I didn't think that might be causing it. But as far as I know, no more seizures.
Thanks for that update, Paul. Thanks for sharing. All right, friends, let's stand and sing a little bit. Our greeting this morning is from number 328. Surely, the presence of the Lord is in this place. Let us pray. Holy God, Father, Son, and Spirit, we thank you for the joy of life and the gift of this day. The summer season is upon us, a time for recreation and relaxation. The season is framed by holidays in which Americans remember those who sacrificed their lives for our nation and those who labor to provide for their families. We pray your blessing upon those who sacrifice for a greater cause, and we pray your protection upon our nation and her people. Watch over us in this summer season, that we remain mindful of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our gathering song this morning is number 431, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Teach them and to help them grow, to learn, and to mature. Lord, we ask that you watch over them in this summer season, keep them safe, and continue to reveal to them new bits of knowledge which they can use to further their lives and their discipleship in you. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for your love of these events. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We're glad you're here this morning. Stand at the doorway.
He's so late.
That's why he did us.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Susan. Our scripture this morning is the first 18 verses of the 11th chapter of Acts. And it's Peter's retelling of what happened when he was called from Joppa to Caesarea. This is a story you may remember. And so as Peter retells the story, he's speaking to the leaders of the church. This is in the early days of the church. And remember that this the way, it wasn't even known as the church at this point. They weren't being called Christians yet. The way, the followers of Jesus, this came under the Jewish tradition. And so the understanding was that this was the fulfillment of, for the people that were followers of Jesus, they believed that Jesus was the Messiah, and that this was the fulfillment of the Jewish tradition. And so it was for Jewish people. It wasn't for Gentiles. And the way that in those days you knew one from the other was that they were either circumcised as Jews or uncircumcised as Gentiles. And so here's Peter's explanation of what happened to him in Joppa. The apostles and the brothers and sisters throughout Judea heard that even the Gentiles had welcomed God's word. When Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him. They accused him. You went into the home of the uncircumcised and ate with them. Step by step, Peter explained what had happened. I was in the city of Joppa praying, he said, when I had a visionary experience. In my vision, I saw something like a large linen sheet being lowered from heaven by its four corners. It came all the way down to me. As I stared at it, wondering what it was, I saw four-legged animals, including wild beasts, as well as reptiles and wild birds. I heard a voice say, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." And I responded, "Absolutely not, Lord. Nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth." The voice from heaven spoke a second time. Never consider unclean what God has made pure. This happened three times. Then everything was pulled back into heaven. Peter continued. At that moment, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were staying. The Spirit told me to go with them, even though they were Gentiles. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered that man's house. He reported to us how he had seen an angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa, summon Simon, who is known as Peter. He will tell you how you and your entire household can be saved." When I began to speak to them, the Holy Spirit fell on them, just as the Spirit fell on us in the beginning. I remembered the Lord's words, "John will baptize with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, then who am I? Could I stand in God's way? Once the apostles and other believers heard this, they calmed down. They praised God and concluded, "So then God has enabled Gentiles to change their hearts and lives so that they too might have new life." This is the word of God for the people of God. I did not get invited to deliver the commencement address at the University of Virginia this year. Again. I didn't get invited to give the commencement address at my own alma mater, VCU or Union Seminary. Surely, I thought, this was the year between Nancy Turner and Dawn Bacon that I would get to speak commencement at Southside Virginia Community College or one of the area high schools, or at least get to speak to the fifth grade class graduating Victoria Elementary. No, it didn't happen. The commencement address sat on my desk, unused and unspoken, until this morning. I'm going to celebrate with you the 2016 congregation of Antioch United Methodist Church, the 2016 church. Congregation of Antioch United Methodist Church, family, friends, and guests, thank you for allowing me to address you on this most honorable occasion. Church of 2016, you have accomplished so much. You've received from your teachers a tradition of faith. They have passed on to you the knowledge they obtained from studying the Bible and applying the principles learned there. Your mentors and guides have taught you that you must practice your faith in order to truly understand it. Your ancestors and teachers have left you a beautiful facility where you can share your knowledge and tradition, a place to come and worship, study, learn, and grow. You have done your part to maintain this beautiful place, to pass the torch on to yet another generation that will follow you. With boldness and an eye toward the future, you have knocked down walls and created new entryways, literally and figuratively, opening up access to those who might never otherwise have graced these doors. You've been a leader in service to others, combating hunger in our beloved community, and working to eradicate malaria on the other side of the world. You have picked up litter, built porches, painted homes, sponsored children, packaged emergency kits, and given emergency money, loving God and loving neighbors, because that's what we do. We lovingly care for one another, gifts of food, notes of gratitude, being there when being there was what was needed. You've been there to love and nurture children and love and support the elders. You've been there planting the seeds of Christ's love and harvesting them. For in this place, your faith has been cultivated and prepared for this very day. Your heart has been opened to the love of Christ, your mind opened to the good news of the gospel, your spirit opened to the Spirit of God, and joined together, one a body with the other. Church of 2016, as you prepare to leave this place to make your mark upon the world, know that you are always welcome to return here. You can always, at any time in life and any place in your life's journey, return here to again be loved and cared for, nurtured and pruned. For your real work, though, your life's calling lies outside these doors. So Church of 2016, live boldly with all the confidence as a child of God, changing the world in Christ's name. As you are a disciple of Christ Jesus, go with courage and determination to make disciples of others. And wherever you go, whatever you do, be open to the leading of God's Spirit, so that the world which God so loves can change you too. That's right. By the Spirit of God and the graces that God has poured out upon you and onto you and into you, you have been transformed and improved and molded. But that is a work in progress. It's ongoing work. It is, in fact, a lifelong process. In other words, believe it or not, you don't know everything. And you will still learn and grow and be changed by the world out there. Christian writer Rachel Held Evans describes this very well. She writes, "When I prepared to graduate, when I sat where you are now, I thought the world needed my answers. But as it turns out, I needed the world's questions. I needed to learn how to doubt well, listen better, and be humbled at times by how little I really knew. As a Christian, I needed to discover that being evangelical, like us, is just one table in Christ's great banquet hall, the great cloud of witnesses far more sprawling and diverse than I'd ever imagined. The world, it turns out, is not all weeds. Sure, there's evil growing, and fear, and hate, and prejudice. But there's also life sprouting out of all sorts of unlikely soil, enough wheat for a lifetime of harvesting. I'm so thankful," she says, "for the people and things that helped me discover that. They challenged everything I knew, and I'm glad. Oh, I resisted at first, worried about compromising my beliefs. I clenched them more tightly, and I dug in my heels, so convinced it was my job to be Jesus to others. I nearly missed the chance to let others be Jesus to me, to teach me and heal me, love me, and call me to repentance. And lest you think that I now, after all these many years, count myself as finished, know this. God uses Bible-thumping, church-going, know-it-all conservatives to teach bleeding-heart, politically correct, question-everything liberals how to be human, to challenge their notions of who the enemy is. And for those Bible-thumping, church-going, know-it-all conservatives, God insists on using bleeding heart, politically correct, question everything liberals to teach how to be human and to challenge their notions of who the enemy is. God, it seems, is rather stubbornly committed to extracting me from the notion that life is all about being right and then wielding my self-righteousness over others like a hammer. Yes, Scripture does warn us against conforming to the patterns of this world, and that is awesome advice. Indeed, the world of the early Christians and the world of today tends to favor the destructive patterns, power over humility, materialism over generosity, retribution over forgiveness. But even the first apostles allowed themselves to be challenged by the goodness of the world. As we heard in this morning's scripture, when the law-abiding, kosher-eating, Roman-hating Peter encountered a Roman centurion who feared God and gave to the poor, to his own astonishment, Peter says, "I now realize how true it is that God doesn't show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right." He even goes so far as to share a meal with his new friend. Says Peter, "You're well aware that it's against the law for me, a Jew, to associate with or visit with you, Cornelius, a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean." Says Peter, "I really am learning." So, Church of 2016, this is my small bit of wisdom for you. Be humble. Continue learning. Just this week, I learned a few things about myself and the world in which I live and serve, including this little tidbit. Commencement is a celebration not of the end of school, but the beginning of life. To commence something is to begin it. Commencement celebrates the beginning of the next phase of life. It's like crossing a threshold. It's like baptism or death giving way to resurrection. What lies beyond today is unknown. And how exciting is that? What will happen? Who you will meet? Where you will go? What you do with these opportunities when you walk out these doors today, when you cross this threshold, is up to you. So, Church of 2016, may the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ go with you wherever He may send you. May He guide you through the wilderness, protect you in the storm. May He bring you home rejoicing at the wonders you have shown. And yes, may He bring you back home rejoicing once again into these doors. Thank you. Friends, I invite you now to take out your hymnals and turn to number 883. Our affirmation of faith this morning is from the United Church of Canada. There is no United Methodist Church present in the nation of Canada. Many years ago, the United Methodist Church joined with other U.S.-based Protestant denominations to come together in unity and form the United Church of Canada. And their affirmation of faith, or at least this one of their affirmations, is included in our hymnal and is part of our liturgy this morning. So will you stand as we affirm our faith together? We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our song of grace is number 451, Be Thou My Vision. Church leaders, church elders, have written pastoral letters to their flock. The New Testament is full of such letters. Paul's letter to the church in Rome and the church in Corinth, Thessalonians, Philippi, among others. We have received this week a letter from our United Methodist Council of Bishops, a pastoral letter that I'm going to read to you to share with you this morning in the tradition of our faith. To the people of the United Methodist Church, the Council of Bishops brings you greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who has called us to be servant leaders of the church. In 1812, Bishop Francis Asbury, Bishop William McKendry, and General Conference Secretary Daniel Hint sent the first letter to churches following General Conference. This letter seeks to revive that tradition. Hundreds of lay and clergy delegates from around the world gathered in Portland, Oregon, along with bishops and pastors, church members and staff, volunteers and visitors, to engage in Christian conferencing, to make decisions for our church's future, to affirm our global connection, to worship and celebrate God's faithfulness. We celebrated the success of our Imagine No Malaria initiative, which seeks to raise $75 million in the fight against malaria, a disease that takes the life of a child in Africa every 2 minutes. We celebrated our ecumenical partnerships as we move into full communion with the Uniting Church in Sweden and toward full communion with the Moravian Church. We celebrated our heritage, the 250th anniversary of our oldest church, John Street, the 200th anniversary of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, the 150th anniversary of United Methodist Women, the 25th anniversary of Africa University. We continued in our acts of repentance with a presentation from the Cheyenne and Arapaho tribes about the Methodist involvement in the 1864 Sand Creek Massacre. We shared the consecration of deaconesses and home missioners and the commissioning of missionaries. We moved toward a global book of discipline and global social principles. We voted to add 5 new bishops in Africa after 2020 and approved a church-wide study on our organization. The Episcopal Address set the tone for the event, focusing on humility and lifting up our accomplishments. We heard from our laity an invitation to members to be more involved in making disciples and getting involved in ministries to bring the love of Christ to others. We heard our young people say, they are engaged in Christ's journey with energy and love. And we also heard them clearly say that they do not want a divided church and urged us to be in unity even if we do not have unanimity. They give us hope for our future. The body had difficult and challenging work before it as we acknowledged our differences over human sexuality. Amidst those differences, the delegates affirmed that they want their bishops to lead, and we found ourselves with an opportunity for a holy moment. We spoke candidly about what divides us and what our church might look like in the future if we dare to consider new possibilities. We offered a way forward, postponing decisions about sexuality matters and committing to having a different kind of global conversation that allows all voices to be heard. Our differences do not keep us from being the body of Christ. They do not keep us from doing good in the world. They do not keep us from making a difference. And so we set forth bold new goals: to make 1 million new disciples of Jesus Christ, to engage 3 million new people to make a difference in the world, to transform 400 communities for vital, abundant living, to reach 1 million children with life-saving interventions, and to double the number of vital congregations. Most importantly, we affirmed our commitment to stay united. We proved that we are more than debates and divisions, more than rules and resolutions. We stood together as the body of Christ. As we reflect on our time in Portland, our prayer is for unity in the church, for the advancement of our mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ, for the transformation of the world. As John Wesley reminded us, best of all, God is with us. Signed on behalf of the Council of Bishops, Bishop Bruce R. Hall, President of the Council. Lori, will you grab the prayer list for me off the two podiums?
Yes.
Thank you. Friends, let us pray. Compassionate God, loving God, merciful God, we give you thanks for this day and this gathering of your disciples who come to this place handed down to us from earlier ancestors to continue the tradition of worship here at Antioch. We thank you, O Holy One, that we can come together, united in our desire to worship you. Compassionate God, we pray for the renewal of our church and our community. We pray that you will send us the people no one else wants, the lost, the seeking, the broken. Help us and guide us to love them like we love ourselves. And when they come, open our hearts and minds to receive them and to receive the gifts you send by them, that we too can learn from them and grow with them as together we become the body of Christ. Lord, we pray today for the work of Lunenburg Ministries and this week for Neighbors Helping Neighbors. We pray for all of those who are working behind the scenes to make this ministry vital and life-changing in our community. We pray for all of those volunteers who will come out taking time away from their other interests and willing to make an investment in the lives of others. And we pray for those who will receive our services. May we learn from them and grow as the body together. We pray for the United Methodist Church. Mold us, make us into instruments for building up the kingdom of God. And assuming our place as your will leads and guides, Lord, in the larger universal Christian church. Loving God, through the person of Jesus Christ, you said there is no greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. And then you showed us, as you gave up your life for us. Today, with gratitude, we remember the men and the women who gave their lives for our sake in service to our nation, fighting to preserve freedom and the ideals of liberty and justice for all. Like the Christian martyrs, they were willing to die for the greater good. May we be so courageous. Merciful God, we lift up and place before you those whose bodies are broken, and those whose spirits are broken, those who are in need of healing, and those whom we lift up and name before you now. Teresa George, Dorothy Shields, Kathy and Lee Barnhill, Dick and Karen Griffin, Vernon and Virginia G., Alan Langley, Margaret Gregory, Rachel Jackson. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For Charles and Teresa Hudson, Renee Nash, Dorothy Driscoll, Helen Holder, Ray Hathcock, Wayne Hendricks, Tammy Green, Barbara Callis, Wendy Ripberger, and Audrey Smith, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For the unspoken on our hearts this day, for Eleanor and Roger Wright, Woody Wright, for those who are traveling this holiday, and for the families of deceased veterans. We pray for Tom and Linda Dunlap, Jacob Bacon, Jean Keeling, Margaret Wilkerson. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Continue prayer for Ashby Murray, for Caroline West, Renee Nash, William Hicks, and Bob Rumlow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, as children of God, we come together now, united in one voice, to pray the prayer that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let us continue to worship God with the giving of our tithes and offerings. And I ask that we also bring forward at least some of the food that we will be blessing and taking to the new religion today. Will the ushers come? Their kitchen, of the money which they have worked hard to earn, to do the work of bringing your kingdom to reality, feeding the hungry, to clothing and housing, building up your kingdom. Accept these gifts that we offer in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. Friends, our hymn of song of discipleship this morning is number 413. A charge to keep my head. So go, my friends, in peace of Jesus Christ, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. to love and serve the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Now, turn to number 696 in the back of your hymnal. And we're going to sing the first verse of America the Beautiful.